You're a content creator. I'm sure you've heard of agents doing all your content for you. If you're a developer, you're aware of large and small language models. You're going to meet the chef who combines all those together as the leading chef of this revolution of cooking with AI for agents and small language models. I am so pleased to introduce to the world someone you may have seen on YouTube or LinkedIn. It is Chef Fabian Williams. He's the principal product manager at Microsoft and Substrate. Chef Williams, welcome to the kitchen.
Hey, John. Thank you for having me. Good to be here.
Oh my gosh, this is so exciting. So if you look at the LinkedIn feed of Chef Williams, you'll see him traveling all over the world sharing different recipes for AI. And I'm so proud that you are wearing your, I forgot my chef's jacket today, so I feel a little underdressed, but you're representing so well. So Chef Williams, can you introduce the audience to your world of AI a bit?
Sure, absolutely. So by day, I am, as you mentioned before, a principal product manager on Microsoft Graph Core, specifically around data and services, where my focus is on the developer experience for Copilot 3 and for M365 extensibility. When I'm not doing that, as you mentioned before, I do come from a tech community before joining Microsoft. So I do a lot of public speaking all over the world, inside the United States. And I'm always tinkering. So I'm always, you know, thinking about what we can be doing next, you know, to leverage the richness and data that we have in M365. And, you know, I take that whether it's a large language models that we're running in Azure AI or sometimes, you know, small language models that we're running on our local PCs or Macs.
And I understand your agent is able to help you create content.
Absolutely. It certainly does. So I'm always looking to, you know, to how can I scale myself? And you know, when I'm creating content, I'm looking at all of the different streams of work that I need to do and all the different channels where I'm putting stuff out. So, you know, I'd create some content and I need to put it out there on either the blog post or on LinkedIn or on YouTube, but then I need to also socialize that so people can actually see it. So you need to create, you know, a narrative around that also on LinkedIn, maybe on X and also on other channels as well. So I could cut and paste that like I was doing before, or I can find a way to automate that using agents.
Can you show us how you use your agent?
Sure, absolutely. So let's actually start over here in Visual Studio Code. And this is a simple console application for now, but there's no reason why this could actually be a little bit more robust. And when I create this agent, I also want to look at it from the perspective of what can I do locally, because that's where I want to run it. But sometimes you may meet into where your mileage may vary, because even though a model that can run on your PC can do function and tool calling, which is what we're going to be doing here today, sometimes depending on the complexity of what you want, you don't necessarily get the desired results. So I set it up so that you can actually run it both locally or also hosted. And you can think about this like a test rig. Eventually, you're going to run it locally, but you want to test it with a larger model just to make sure that you can get that compute. And sometimes you may want to hand off stuff to a larger model and then do some of the smaller complexity stuff to the local model. So I'm just going to run it now. Right now, I'm going to run it. And let's talk about actually what the agents do. So we have a configure agent here, and we have an agent that is actually a YouTube agent, a blog agent, a social media agent, and we have a technical reviewer and a copy edit reviewer. And we have a technical and a copy edit reviewer because we want to make sure that, yes, it's me sometimes when I'm copying and pasting, I can say, yep, that makes sense, that makes sense. But when you're giving it to an LLM or an AI.
Why do you have so many agents again?
Because you want to be able to have discrete roles. So I have one that's focused for YouTube, one that's focused for blog, and one that's focused for social media. All right. So let's go ahead and run it so you can actually see it. So let me go ahead and do a clear. And as a part of the setup, let me actually show you that inside here under my repos folder, underneath where my blog is located under data, under transcripts, I actually have a folder called Fabian and Doug. And I had a conversation with my friend Doug Ware, an MVP, just yesterday, and I have a transcript with all of that information. So we're starting with that. So now I'm actually going to say, if I come here, I'm going to say .NET run, and I'm going to say Fabian and Doug. And I'm going to go ahead and let me just move this out of the way so we can actually see the full runtime. All right. So it's generating content for Fabian and Doug right now. We won't leave it because it's actually going to go pretty fast. So, well, as long as it doesn't, there you go. So right now we actually have the generated title. It's printing out content for the blog post. Just over a little bit.
And when you first began cooking your content mm-hmm. this way, how did you feel mm-hmm. about it? Did you feel like maybe you were cheating, or how did it strike you?
I didn't feel like I was cheating. I felt that actually I was doing more of the creative work and leaving mm-hmm. a lot of the churn, you know, the minutia stuff to an agent. And I think that allows me to, you know, to do other things and also to think about this more. So before I would only have a very few channels that I would go out to. Now I actually have, I'm saying maybe I can do this for Reddit. Maybe I can actually mm-hmm. do this, you know, and for automate the entire GitHub process as well too. So this gives me a way of doing that. It says right now, workflow completed for Fabian and Doug. So actually, let's go take a look at that. So if I come back over to Finder, and if I go to inside social media drafts, I have this now, wow. Fabian and Doug.txt. Let me see if I can make this a little bit bigger for us, because I know it's a little bit small, Control++++. Mm-hmm. And we can see here, dive into the world of software patterns with Fabian and Doug, join your discussion mm-hmm. with John Maeda, identifying anti-patterns. And it gives me a link to put that for my YouTube with even hashtags as well. If I go to YouTube drafts, I actually have inside here the Fabian and Doug, mm-hmm. Which is basically the title. I have keywords. It gives me all of my keywords that I can actually use. Control+. And it also gives me a description that I can use. Let me open up that description here as well.
So I've heard of this called like doing versus reviewing. When you're working with agents, you're doing more reviewing than doing. Does that sound correct?
Exactly. That sounds absolutely correct. It goes to the point that we're talking about before. The way that I would think about it is that years before LLM became so popular, you would, as a human being, you would basically do work and you would do, 95% of that work. And then the last mile you'll give to the agent not agent in that time, you'll give to a spell check or you'll give to some type of other, machine in order to do that last polish for you. Now it's flipped on its head. And I would say that now you give the agents and you give the LLMs the bulk of the work to do. And then you come in and do that review process at the end of the last mile. So it's flipped on its head.
And you know, Chef Williams, you've talked a bit about, you mentioned this can run local. So can you go back and tell us about your local journey? Why is it called local?
Why is it called local? It's called local because, let's actually come over to here. If I go to iTerm, if I do all llama, it's bigger control. If I do all llama list, these are actually models that I have on my machine right now. You can see I have 5.4 here, and I have the 14 billion parameter with a floating point of 16, which is half of what it does. So it's actually, even though 5.4 is small, this is actually a half of it. I also have llama 3.370b, that's a 70 billion parameters with the quantization of 8_0, and I have llama 3.3 latest. So these are models that are out there on either Hugging Face, but I get mine from Olama, and I put it down locally so that I can use it here on my machine.
When you run them, does it cost any money?
It doesn't cost any money. I think that's the benefit, right? So in fact, think about it this way. Not only does it not cost any money, but I can run in a detached mode. So I can, you and I have chatted before when I was actually going on an airplane and I'm actually thinking about our conversation and I'm saying, yeah, let me run it, on my own local LLM. And it was a long flight. I was going overseas. And by the time I got there, I had so much done. It was so productive that I didn't have to be tethered to the internet in order to do work. And I had so much content created from that.
It's like packing a genie into your laptop and getting on the airplane.
It certainly is. It certainly is. And I think that these local models are also very purposeful. I think I ran an experiment in my last YouTube video that basically put the 5.4.14b up against the 3.370b. And Llama 4 is really tuned for mathematical computation. So I gave it something that is, you know, that is required you to do factorials, you know, and then reevaluate that factorial, and the 5.4.14b outperformed that. This little 29 gigabyte file outperformed the 74 gigabyte file in the end.
Well, you know, Chef Williams, I think of you like the James Bond of this LLM revolution. I know you got a lot of tools that you can't talk about yet, but these LLMs can use tools, and you have a setup to do all kind of magical things.
It is, right. So let me preface the conversation by saying that it's my belief that you should be able to, in this agent framework that we live in, be able to call the tools that you already either have in existence already. So companies that are not going to start this journey net new, they already have APIs that they've already created. So as long as that API, you know, is backed by an open API specification, which just describes what the API does, I want to be able to have a world where you should be able to just dynamically, through an utterance, call, you know, say what you need, and then through that open API specification, it infers that conversation and determines which function to call. As in this case right here, where we had the content creation, I basically, said, here's a transcript. Go ahead and create something for YouTube, create something for my blog post, create something for LinkedIn. We have all of our different methods to generate the YouTube title, to generate the YouTube description. And then we have prompts down here that actually tells it, ensure that the blog post references the YouTube title. It provides the name, which is why we had to do the .NET run with the name, so it knows exactly where to go. Provide a summary for each of the key reactions. Down here, we actually have draft a concise and engage in social media posts promoting the YouTube video with the name again. And then further down, we actually have where the reviewers will actually take over and actually review for technical accuracy, review and improve grammar, tone, and style. And then what the eventuality is for me to train it against the stuff that I've already done so it understands my tone and my style.
And I know that this is a different topic. I've seen you also fine-tuning models. I mean, is there something you haven't done yet in this AI revolution?
Well, I think I'm only limited by the amount of hardware resources that I have on this machine. So the answer is yes. In fact, I was trying to do some Microsoft Graph work on this machine, and that is when I really found out that your mileage may vary when it comes to the models, because Llama 3.3 can do tool calling and can do function calling. But when I gave it just the open API specification from Microsoft Graph, which actually has parameters, it has audio queries that you can do with filters and so on and so forth, the LLM could not, the local LLM could not reason over the open API schema to determine what to call and how to call it properly. But when I gave that to a hosted model, even with GPT 4.0, it worked perfectly. So I'm constrained by the power of my machine and the size of the models that are here.
Just like a chef. But I know that you love the small language models because it's also a chance to cook over fire, right?
It is. So the way I think about it is that you may want, as much as you may trust, and you should trust, you know, your vendors, you have different vendors out there. Of course, I, just like yourself, work for Microsoft. So we have Azure, and Azure has trust and compliance built into everything that it does. You know, human beings have this primal instinct of wanting to do things by hand. You know, it's easier to do it up in the cloud, but you want to bring it back. It's almost like, you know, cooking over a gas stove, or going outside and cooking over, you know, charcoal or cooking over wood. So there are times where I would like, possibly even in my work in progress or as I ideate stuff, I would like to do that locally. It's not ready for human consumption yet. It's not ready for prime time. So I want to be able to have the flexibility with my small language model in order to do that work before taking it up to a hosted environment.
The audience has caught a glimpse of Chef Williams' voluminous processes. And I hope you check out all of the content he has online. It's riveting, it's pushing the envelope. And Chef Williams, do you have any closing advice to developers out there who are just now joining this revolution?
Sure, absolutely. Your only limits are your imagination and the amount of time that we can bring, to make these language models more accessible to you. I think that, at least I have a certain tenets that I try to live by on this journey, especially when I put these content out on YouTube. One is that we should get these models in the hands of ordinary users, in its most basic and unvarnished way, not just, through a chat window, but here's the model, go play with it, go think about stuff. And then, but I understand also that not everyone can do this in its current state right now, because you need either a powerful machine with a lot of GPUs, you need to also have access to these models, and different quantization size of it. But in the end, we can't ignore the fact that there is a cycle for us to basically iterate and become better. Large companies are going to create these large models, and they're going to give you all of the power that you need to do complex tasks. But we also need to also prime that with the imagination of the average user, the regular user behind a computer, with all of their ideas. So, because in the end, large companies need to solve for the problems of their users. So we want the users to basically give those ideas, and we can just iterate through those cycles.
Well, thank you so much for visiting the Cozy AI Kitchen. I know we're going to have to see a lot more of Chef Williams. I'm sure you're excited about the stuff that he's been cooking. Thank you so much for joining us, and thank you, Chef Williams.
Thank you for having me again, John. Cheers.